This webinar is sponsored by Farrier Product Distribution. FPD distributes horseshoes, nails, tools, and other hoof products for the professional farrier. Some of the brands and products they distribute are Kirkhart Horseshoes, Vector Horseshoe Nails, Bloom Forge Tools, Liberty Nails, and their own range of tools, to name a few. You can find these quality products distributed by FPD at your local supply shop or those that you purchase from online. You can learn more about FPD and the companies they represent by visiting their site at farrierproducts.com. When you go there, you'll see their commitment to education with informative tools like their newsletter and instructional videos. So again, I'd like to thank FPD for sponsoring this webinar.
Well, I'd like to thank Jeremy and welcome everyone. I have the first few slides. I've prepared some, I'm going to read some information off of sheets here, and then we'll go and get going on the shoeing part. This morning I was thinking about the first two lines of the ad for this webinar. When a thoroughbred horse crosses the finish line at any racetrack, the jockey and trainer often get the spotlight. Don't forget about the crucial role played by the farrier in that horse's success. Those two sentences made me think back to the morning of June 6, 2012. I was getting ready to do the single most important shoeing job of my life. I was shoeing I'll Have Another for his attempt to be the first Triple Crown winner in 34 years. I thought it would be wise to call a couple of farrier friends that had experience with shoeing at Belmont Racetrack, also known as Big Sandy. I called Ray Amato. He told me that he used turndowns in Todd Fletcher's barn, but if I'll Have Another was training well, he'd do just fine. I then called Curtis Burns. He said Big Sandy had beaten many champions, but if I'll Have Another handled the track like he handled Churchill Downs, then we'd have nothing to worry about. Then I called my friend Steve Norman. Steve said, Jimmy, not too many people know whose shoes I'll Have Another, but if he gets sore or loses a shoe in the race, everybody's going to know your name. Needless to say, I didn't call Steve the day before this webinar. This is my good friend and mentor, Mr. Ray Amato. In 1972, after graduating from high school, I went to New York with trainer Bobby Frankel to watch and learn from Ray. While working for Bobby, first as a groom, then as a barn foreman, I watched every horse that Ray shod for us. And when he had an interesting hoof issue in another barn, he would allow me to watch while he worked on it. In those days of the JHU, the Journeyman Horseshoers Union, you weren't allowed to have an apprentice, so all I could do was watch, ask questions, and learn from one of the best in the business. Ray was very kind with his time and knowledge, and the only way I can repay him is do the same for anyone that I can help. I returned from New York in December 1972 and worked as a groom for trainer Buddy Hirsch at Santa Anita Racetrack. My father had told me that Buddy was the best horseman he had ever met, and this would be a great opportunity. In those days, there was a two-year waiting list to get into Cal Poly San Luis Obispo Horseshoeing School, and I had only been on the list for 6 months since graduating from high school. In January 1973, I drove to San Luis Obispo to meet instructor Gene Armstrong, armed with letters of recommendation from past graduates, and expressed my sincere interest in becoming a farrier. I knew that from each class of 16 students, only one and occasionally two graduates went on to become full-time farriers, and I wanted Gene to know that I would be one of the students that would. 6 weeks later, I got my acceptance letter for the spring course, and as you can see by this picture, there were only 15 graduates, as one gentleman quit the very first day. I'm sitting under the lamppost, and I, along with the gentleman to my right, were the only two graduates to go on to become full-time farriers. Gene is an incredible horseman, farrier and instructor, and I was very fortunate to have him teach me early in my career. In 1970, while I was a sophomore in high school, I saw this young lady walk into a classroom. I turned to a friend and told him, "I'm going to marry that girl." In 1973, just 3 months after she graduated high school and I graduated from Cal Poly San Luis Obispo Horseshoeing School, we were married. She had no idea that I'd be working 7 days a week, almost year-round, but she's still here today, and I consider myself very lucky. I know that the politically correct thing to say is family first, but I know that Chris can take care of any family issue, and she knows that there's never been a horse yet that can take care of their own hoof issues. 30 years after being married, we took our first vacation. We were in Maui for 2 weeks, and I had my cell phone and laptop on 24/7 the entire time. I talked to every barn foreman and farrier that was covering for me every morning starting at 3:30 Hawaii time, and then again after the day's races were finished. Every once in a while, she just smiles and says, "I think you work too hard." I like to tell people that if you find yourself in a room where you are the smartest person, move to a new room. Well, this is my room. And as you can see, I've been very fortunate to be around, work with, and work for some of the very best in this industry. Hall of Fame trainers, Hall of Fame farriers, and world-class veterinarians have been in my life since I was 12 years old. Everything I have and everything I know came from these people, and I'm very well aware I won't be leaving this room in my lifetime. I have worked with trainer Doug O'Neill since 1994, and I believe the creation of Team O'Neill was on August 13, 2004. On that day, Doug claimed a horse named Lava Man for $50,000. After the race, the trainer told him, "You just claimed one of the worst-footed horses I've ever seen in my life." Not to be outdone, Doug replied, "Jimmy will take care of that." It took an entire barn effort to keep Lava Man going, but we all did our jobs, and he went on to win or place in 12 graded stakes, most of them grade one, while earning over $5.2 million and is considered the greatest claim in the history of racing. I have always been a person that has set very high goals in my life and in my career. Goals like shoeing for Hall of Fame trainers, shoeing for leading trainers, shoeing graded stake horses, and shoeing Eclipse champions were just a few. But my number one goal was to shoe the winner of all three Triple Crown races. In 1997, while shoeing for Mr. Dave Hoffman's, we won the Belmont Stakes with Touch Gold. Now, in 2012, with trainer Doug O'Neill, I was lucky enough to shoe the winner of the Kentucky Derby and Preakness Stakes with I'll Have Another. Happily, I can say I have now achieved every one of my shoeing related goals that I have set. However, after watching I'll Have Another win the Kentucky Derby and the Preakness Stakes, and after celebrating with the other members of Team O'Neill, I set a new goal to win another Kentucky Derby. And I would like to take this time and opportunity to thank trainer Doug O'Neill and his owners, especially Paul Redham, for having the faith and confidence in my ability to find me all over the world to shoe their horses. In the 1970s, I purchased an Apple IIe because I knew that computers were something that I needed in my business. This is a sample of the information I keep on every horse that I work on. It includes the horse's name, date it was last shod, style and size of shoe, and general notes. I check horses at 25 days and then work out their next shoeing day with the trainer depending on workout, race, and shipping schedules. Each time a horse is shod, their information is also collected on a master list that is stored for at least 2 years. I have had trainers call me many months after a horse has moved on from my care to ask about hoof issues, and I find these notes invaluable to my business. Okay, so here's a sample of the master list I just referred to. And you can see a horse like Boxer de Roux. We've had him in the O'Neill barn for 3 seasons. And these are all the records that I have on him on each shoeing. Oddly enough, I didn't even see this, but I also had I'll have another on here. And only got to shoe him for effectively 1 full year, but what a year it was. I also print my envelopes and business cards off my computer. I like to keep everything looking very professional, have business cards when I go to seminars or when people ask for them. And of course, I print my monthly statement. This statement is sent to the bookkeepers and the trainers both in date form, and then it is sent again in alphabetical form so that the bookkeepers can find all the charges for a particular horse so that they don't need to look at, say, the first for Boxer de Roux, and then maybe on the 15th he has a quarter crack patch. So for the bookkeepers, they'll get all this information alphabetically so all the charges are in line. This is my 2001 Ford F-250 diesel pickup with a stone well truck body. And this is the extendo bed extended. On this side, I keep my chute. You can see there's a couple hand tools, fly sprays. This side of the extendo bed has various tools. It has the welding tanks, a bandsaw, a drill press, propane tank, propane forge, various hand tools, hammers, tongs. I get a lot of people that comment about both the blacksmith sign when they walk around my truck, and they also comment about this right here is a Dutchman shoeing tile where the gentleman is shoeing the horse and he's wearing the wood shoes. A lot of people think that's pretty cool. This side has my multi-tool grinder and knife sharpening buffing wheel. Two items that I use virtually on every horse. Also my anvil and vise. And here you'll see my various glue kits, quarter crack patch kit, hand tools. There'll be a box with some replacement shoes, replacement belts. Nails will be stored on this side, rasps. I use Kirkhart shoes. This first shoe is the King's Plate. I like to use that on my lower heeled or rounded feet. This will be the Tradition. Works great on a more narrow foot. This will be the Fast Break. I'll use this when I want to quickly pull back a toe. All three of these front shoes are Queen's Plate XTs. We do not use toe grabs on the front of the horses. And this will be the hind shoe, which will be a toe grab with a clip on it. We've been using clips for quite some time. We ship a lot of horses from Santa Anita and Hollywood Park and Del Mar when they're racing because we always have a split barn. And we ship horses all over the world, and it's nice to have the horse arrive with all four shoes. This is my truck. How it looks when it's set up at the barn. This is at Hollywood Park. You'll see my extension cord here is now plugged in, so my whole backside extendo bed is hot and all my tools will work. And of course my notes are up on my laptop. They sit on a Giotto desk, and before I start each horse I come in and read my notes. See what I might be looking for. It's about any bruising, how the horse grows high on the inside, or has any flares that need to be dressed. Here's where I shoe horses at Hollywood Park. Several years ago, So he asked me what the ideal situation was to shoe a horse, and I told him a safe, quiet area and definitely having mats. The next day, this was there. He spoils me, I'll say. Years ago, I shot horses for D. Wayne Lucas down at San Luis Rey Downs. I first started shoeing horses in the 70s. One day, Wayne was there, and he came up, and he assistant trainer loved tons of sand in the shed row. And I was shoeing. Wayne asked me, he says, how does this horse's feet look to you? And I said, put the foot down, and I said, they look fantastic. Wayne looked over and he says, well, how can you tell? He's up to his cornet bands in sand. And I said, huh, imagine that. The sand was out of that shed row where I shot the next day. If you can shoe on a flat surface, especially something like mats where the horse is not standing in holes, you're going to be able to see the foot more clearly. The horse is going to be more comfortably, or stand more comfortably, and it's going to be an all-around better situation. Okay, this is going to be a horse that I'm going to demonstrate some shoeing on, and I'm going to start by mentioning, I'm not going to talk about this horse's balance a whole lot. I'm going to refer you to a DVD called 12 Points of Reference, Balancing the Equine Hoof by Roy Bloom, and Dave Farley. If you haven't seen this video, see it. You don't have it, you should buy it. It's great to show clients. This particular horse looks very nice here. She's in balance, knees straight, coming down here. Everything is looking good. Cornet band in relation to the ground is nice. However, we go to the right leg. His knees turned out. This, you can see she's not sitting comfortably. The cornet band is not parallel to the ground. She has a small dish here and a little bit of flaring. She grows very straight on her medial side and has a tendency to roll under. It's a little bit better close-up of the feet that we're going to work on. And you see we're talking about this small dish, and you can see how straight this foot actually is. I'm going to play this video here that was shot by my friend and fellow horseshoer Brian Fitzgerald. I believe he wants to be called Brian Scorsese Fitzgerald from this point forward. Okay, I'm going to talk to you about what we're doing here. I hope this comes up clear enough that you can see it. If not, it will be on the replay. The shoes are off, and we've angled her feet and got her ready for shoeing, and this is the left front foot that needs virtually nothing. We're just doing a little cleanup of any flare on the outside on that one. Now the right foot is a different situation where we're going to have to work on this filly. I mentioned that she was due to be shot, I hope, and she's about 32 days, but she's getting ready to run. Now this filly gets this foot looking a little bit ugly here at the time that she's due, and she's going to run, so we want her to perform at her very best. So we're going to get this foot looking like it should after it's shod properly. Okay, so we've taken a little bit more flare on that side and a little bit of that dish down. Now I've angled this filly and she comes in about 51 degrees. She's going to be up to about 52 once we get some of this toe off. This is going to be about the growth that you're going to see on most thoroughbred horses at the racetrack. She has just under about a quarter of an inch. Now I'm just dipping at her toe. I want to save her heel. She has a nice heel, but I obviously don't want to take her down anymore on her heel. If all horses' feet looked like this, we'd probably all charge a lot less for shoeing. As you can see here, as I'm rasping, I'm just barely brushing the highest point of the frog. So that's a pretty nice heel as far as I'm concerned. She could stand flat and have some frog pleasure whilst her heel is hitting the ground. And when we put a shoe on there, it's not going to make much difference. She's going to get plenty of contact with the ground with her frog. I'm making sure that her wall is symmetrical to her white line. And here I'm just going to go ahead and clean up her bottom of her foot, clean up her frog. This filly's feet look real nice, minus the adjustments that we have to do on her every month on her right side to keep her looking sharp, and has never had any issues. However, we just found a little bruise in her frog. Now, our racehorses train and run on very well manicured racetracks, and these type of bruises still show up. And she has not had an issue with bruising before, so I'm going to assume that she stepped on something, possibly a stone, a loose shoe, and bruised this frog. I'm not going to worry about it at all unless she has one on the opposite side, but I will make a note of it. I try to leave as much foot as I can. We want the foot clean so we don't get any thrush. We try to take out just the growth so she has plenty of protection on the sole and in the frog area. I switched to these wide rafts several years ago, and I think they're incredible. They make it a lot easier for me to level a foot. Now I'm using a king's plate on this filly, and I hope you notice that when I'm shaping my shoe, I try not to go back and forth, so I try not to whack that shoe so hard that I close it up and then have to come right back and open it up. She has a pretty nicely shaped foot, so this is not going to take a lot of work. And once I get my shoe shaped the way I want it, I come back over to my stall jack and I level the bottom of the shoe so there's not going to be any sole pressure once I put the shoe on. Make sure that shoe is level. And then something that I do on every horse, every foot, I bevel the medial side of every shoe at 45 degrees, or close enough to 45 degrees. I found that this will greatly reduce horses stepping off a shoe. I've seen horses stand in wash racks or be moved quickly by a groom or a hot walker near the stall and then step on a shoe, and ever since I started beveling shoes, I greatly reduced those type of lost shoes. It's simple to do. I generally like to walk to and from my truck unless it's raining, of course. Now I'm just looking at this shoe here to make sure I've got no lifts on the heel. I want to make sure that the shoe's flat. I was saying I generally walk to and from the horse to the truck and use my multi-tool to bevel that shoe. If the horse is nervous or it's raining, I'll just use my rasp and do it right here at the horse. Our horses are generally calm. This filly has always been fantastic to shoe. And she's standing real nice here, but on the opposite foot, we got to work on her. We actually had her disappear on us where she was standing and went right to her knees. We stopped filming and had her sedated Normally, I wouldn't have sedated her, but since we had a camera around and a tripod, we didn't want to have any risk that she might hurt herself, so we just sedated her. I have a green light from my trainers to sedate any horse. None of my trainers want to have a horse or a person get injured. The cost of sedation is so minimal that we want to make sure that we're doing what's best for the horse and have them have a good experience. I generally put 6 nails on a size 4 and 6 to 8 on all my shoes. I've held shoes on for races with as few as 2 nails on each side and had no problem. Now this foot's done, we're going to go to the right foot, and that's what we're going to be able to see a little bit more work done. You can see that this foot grows quite a bit higher on the inside. And you can see, I'll point out a little bit later in the video to Brian, that we're talking about it. Brian had shot this horse last time, and he wasn't satisfied with what he had done, but he did a great job on the horse, because this filly will always grow out high. It's just not something that you're going to be able to do to stop her. She has a very, straight roll heel here. So this is what we look at 25 days on her. When we go into the stall and look at her, we look and see how high she's growing, and then evaluate when she's going to run, and then we get her shot accordingly. We may wait until she breezes and shoe her the day she breezes. It all depends on how that foot looks and what her training schedule is. If she's just walking, we'll let her grow a few extra days. Now this heel grows a little bit higher. I'm sure you can see that compared to the other foot. So she is going to have a little heel removed. Once again, I think you'll be able to see as I'm rasping that I barely, if at all, touched the frog. So I still get that nice flat surface. I think I'm going to start a fund to get a new apron here. This is starting to look a little embarrassing. I'm recovering from a shoulder surgery that I had last year, and I was off for 90 days, and then I came back, and the shoulder surgery really wasn't successful, so I had to have another one this year. So my shoeing over the last year has been a little thin, except traveling with horses. I've only been able to get up to about 2 a day. Okay, so now again, we've got the filly's foot cleaned out. We're cleaning her frog, and then we're going to go ahead and rasp her level. And I think you're going to see, I'm just showing Brian there about that roll heel. There's nothing that can be done to this. This foot is going to grow this way. It's the foot that Mother and God gave her, and can't argue with her mother or God, so we're going to work with it as best we can. Now she's still standing pretty nice, but you can see that she's starting to pull that leg away from me. She just got a little irritated about something, not sure what. But I put this foot down here a second, then when I pick it back up, she just decides to take a little rest. She's really a great filly to work on. Once again, trying to get the wall symmetrical to the white line. This foot here, we did a little bit more work on the outside, if you remember. Okay, now I want this filly level to slightly lower on the inside. The reason why I say slightly lower is if you get her level, she's going to be high on the inside in 2 weeks. So if you get her a tick lower on the inside, she's going to grow to level and then grow out high. I've had a lot of success with horses, keeping them from getting sore in those medial heels like that, and it has just worked well for me. Now I'm going to shape this foot, or excuse me, shape this shoe. And then I'm going to finish the cleanup of this shoe out of the truck. And when we come back, you're going to see that the shoe's on, and we're going to see the finished product there. So when I drop this foot, I'm going to the truck. I've got her fit nice and full on the inside. And I hope you can see here that as I shape the shoe, all I've done is close it up. I haven't closed it and reopened it. So I tried to take cautious hammer blows to close my shoes so I'm not working twice by then reopening it. Okay, I'm going to my rig. All right, now here's the final job. She's been clinched. I'm happy the way she looks. We've got this coronet band looking better to the bottom of the foot. She looks nice here. And this is what she looks like standing. Once again, I'll go back to the back. This leg just looks nice, and it still looks nice. I haven't done anything to mess that up. And on this side here, I think we've improved her. We got her back to where she is balanced. She looks good here. Looks good from the coronet pan on both sides. And she's ready to go do her best in a week. Please do not forget the hind feet. I realize that the hind feet follow the front feet, but I see so many horses that are not taken care of behind, and I just don't understand it. In California, we're seeing more and more horses that are sore in their back end, hocks, stifles, and in their back. And I think a lot of it has to do with these feet not being dressed. Now, this is a horse that's due. I think he's 35 days. He doesn't look bad, but you can see right here that this foot here is starting to flare out a little bit. And just dressing that back will get him looking. This is his left hind. And this is his right. This is the way you want this horse to look. This is the way you want this horse to train. And this horse is balanced, in my opinion. This horse is not. This is the right hind foot of a horse that we claim. He came out of his race so sore on his right hock, it was almost sad. This foot obviously has not been taken care of. And that's what it took to take care of him. One shoeing. He's fit full here. You see my bevel. So if he does step here, it's has a chance of sliding off, a good chance of sliding off. And this foot is what this horse needs to stay sound. He never went back looking the other way as long as we had him. He did have to have his hock injected because he was so sore, but he only had it injected once. Once we got this horse balanced out, going straight, he never had to be injected again, and his hock's fully out. We're going to look at some feet that I've taken pictures of, and we'll talk about some of the issues that we see at the racetrack. This filly came in from the ranch where she was doing some training, and she was very sore. And we see these two toe cracks. Nothing out of normal, you know. Not normal, you know, that we don't see. And you can see this toe crack here on the right side. You can just see it a little bit more clearly here. What was really interesting, this filly was awfully sore. So Dr. Ryan Carpenter took some x-rays so that we can get some idea about what we were looking at on the inside. Well, we see that she has some rotation. But then we also see this toe crack and just see how high that toe crack actually goes. So this filly needs to be pulled back a little bit to help her break over. I want to dress those toe cracks. And this is a really good picture of just that toe crack on the one foot. You can see that goes up about, I'm going to say a good inch and a half on her foot. A reminder, this is the way she looked. And she's sore. And this is what we did. We glued aluminum shoes on using Grand Circuit glue. We took her toes back. And you can see there's a little glue right here where that toe crack was. But just taking the foot back took both of these toe cracks out. She walked for about 5 days. We think that she irritated the laminitis issues. And then she started training and never had an issue again. And the toe cracks didn't come back on this one. This is just a sample of sticky shoes. I use sticky shoes in my practice. These have a rubber bonding on the bottom, and they're glued on with a super glue type glue. They have two clips. This horse was pretty sore, and we tried these shoes on him here because of the bonding. And we removed nothing from the bottom of his foot. So we left all the protection on this horse that's sore, put the sticky shoes on with no nails. Now, if this horse was going to run, we would let this horse run probably up to about 10 days without even thinking about putting the nail in there. I put these shoes on for 30 days with no nails. And I've also had them loosen up a little bit where I have to put a nail on each side. But it's no big deal to throw a nail here, or in any part of the foot that you feel you have a good, safe wall area, and these shoes stay on well. This is a horse called Dominator that has some pretty obvious bruising in its toe area. He was very sore. What we did is we glued his shoes to take away the nail factor. And now we have to deal with this bruising area. What I used is some Equithane and some Equimesh. As you can see and figure out, is that this shoe is glued on. If the Equithane was under a nail shoe, it would be over here. And this, if the Equimesh rather was under a glue shoe, a nail shoe, it would be over here. And the Equithane would stay in better. Well, we don't have that luxury on this situation. So what I did is I put the Equimesh in there and then squirted the Equithane in there. Now, I have experienced that this can stay into maybe 5 to 7 days. But this horse is so sore, we're going to put this in them 2-3 times over the next 20 to 30 days until he gets feeling better. If it comes out, and it occasionally will, you just clean up the foot, put it back in, and even if you have to put it in 3 or 4 or 5 times over the case of the month, you're giving this horse what he needs, some protection. This went in 3 times over a course of 20 days. When it came out the third time, the horse was 100% sound. These shoes stayed on him over 45 days. And once the shoes started to get questionable, we took them off, shod the horse, cut out all that bruising, and he never had an issue again. It was just getting over that hump where we had to use this Equithane and Equimesh. This is a horse that is very, very sore in his heels. He has a nice foot, but he has really badly bruised his heels. You cannot put a glue shoe on this horse, a regular shoe, nor a sticky shoe, because if you do, he's going to resent it, and he's not going to get better. I use a flip-flop shoe. Now, this is an impact pad, and I put it on a shoe. You see it there. And then I cut this out. The reason why I cut this out is because I want the dirt to clear, and I want these heels protected by the pad. He has no pressure from the shoe, and this flip-flop pad, I've used it to run horses, and anytime I get a sore-heeled horse, this is one of my very first tools. It makes a little flip-flop sound when the horse is walking on the concrete to and from the racetrack, and the rider always wonders what's going on the first time they get on them, but they run very well with this shoe, and it's very effective for getting a horse over some sore heels. This is a horse called Ever a Friend. I was called in by trainer Mike Mitchell to look at this horse, and this was diagnosed as canker. I don't have a lot of experience with canker, but I know that this is a very sore area of the frog that needs to have some help. And you can see the dirt is getting into this tissue, and we need to take care of this. What I did is I took a Perkart Triumph shoe. It's a wider web, a little thicker shoe. And I drilled and tapped for some flathead machine screws. You see my four screw holes here. To that, I applied a hospital plate. Now, this plate can be removed after the horse trains. He'll go to the track with the plate on, walk, get paid, go into the stall, and then the plate will be removed. The foot would be allowed to dry, and then medicated, bandaged for the night. And then the next day, we start all over again. Now, this plate will protect that area and allow that sore spot to heal. He healed up in about 6 weeks and went on the train just fine. Now, I've used the hospital plate as a go-to for some serious issues in my past. And I had a horse called Cara Cortado that trainer Mike Mitchell bred, owned, and trained. And he was always sore in his heels and his medial heels and his frog. We used various shoes on him, glue shoes, polyflex shoes glued on, hospital plates, three-quarter shoes was what he trained in the best. But just before my surgery in November of 2011, he ran in the Breeders' Cup, and getting him to the race was just an incredible feat. Mike did a great job, but he had a lot of problems with his foot, and we just couldn't figure out what's going on. We put a hospital plate on him and got him there, and then I shot him for the race, and then I had my surgery. Well, about 2 weeks later, Mike Michalski called me up, and he said, "Boy, this horse is awfully sore. You need to look at him. I mean, he's got a mess on his frog." Well, I went to Santa Anita to look at him, and this next slide is not the way he looked the day I saw him. But he was very sore in his frog, and the frog was separating. There was a lot of pus in the frog, and it was a mess. And I even questioned whether or not he was going to survive. He was so sore, I was worried that he was going to founder on the other foot. Now, these pictures are courtesy of Mike Michalski and Dr. Sarah Birch. They continued working on this horse because, as I said, I had a surgery and I was not shoeing horses. And the new horse shoer, Mike Lynn, continued on with the hospital plate. You see he's got this extended back. He puts the hospital plate on. This horse went through hyperbaric chamber treatments, multiple different medications to get this thing to heal up. And believe me, I was concerned about him. And this is what fell out of that hole, or was cut out of that hole. That was the frog in that area. As it dried up, they medicated it with different medications, probably bluing and things like that. And as it dried up, they cut that out, and that was the tissue that you saw there before. This is what happened when they cut that out. Now, needless to say, he was sore for a long time. But he started to get better. And Mike's very patient with his horses. He gave this horse all the time he needed. This horse is a graded stakes winner of over $850,000, but he is a gelding, so he has no stud value later on. This value is as a racehorse. This is a picture a couple weeks later. You can see he's healing up pretty nicely. And this is a picture. Mike Lynn just shot this guy about 3 days ago, and this is the way the foot looks now. Now, Mike was telling me that he's having a little problem right in here, that he'll get sore. And you can see when this foot expands that he's probably going to have some issues. He put an aluminum bar shoe on the other day, and I talked to Mike today, and he said that the horse is training well. He's looking forward to possibly running him in early February. I like to say, know what you don't know. And if you're not sure about something, get some help. Go on the internet, research. Do the things you have to do before you do something that you're not sure of. This is a filly called Mystical Plant that came in, and she was as sore as a boil. And these are the shoes that she had glued on her. You can see that is too much glue. She's sore in her heel, and she is awfully sore in her sole area. This is not the proper way to glue shoes. She has too much glue on here. She's sore just because of that buildup of glue. This is the other front foot. You can see this is all glue. I kind of wonder how much of this may have shipped out, but we got her shot up. Now, these are the shoes removed, and I would conservatively say that a person could probably glue three pair of shoes on with the amount of glue that's on this one pair of shoes, and you can pretty well see why she was uncomfortable. We got her shot up. This is the way she looked when she was finished. And this was the bottom of her foot. There's no visible bruising. She walked away absolutely sound, just taking off that excess glue and that pressure. She walked away 100% sound and never had an issue. We never did have any clue as to why she was glued or what the problem could have been. Now, this is a photo of a horse that Mike Mitchell claimed, and he called me up the evening after he claimed and he said, please come to my barn tomorrow. You need to help me. I claimed the horse, and he looks terrible. I don't know why this horse ran this way. If I was the paddock judge, I would have sent him home. I wouldn't have allowed him to run like this. But it's possible that the horse has tender feet. Possible the owner wasn't paying his bill. I'm not sure what the explanation is, but this is a type of job that probably the farrier probably should have come over to me and explained to me what was going on here. You know, the owner wasn't paying the bill, so the trainer wouldn't allow him to shoe the horse or something. I would have shot this horse for free before I allowed him to run. We used fast brakes on this horse here. You can see he's elongated, got this dish. The horse's ankles were pretty sore. So we put some fast brakes on him. Got all this area back to nice wall. Still got 8 nails in him with no problem. This is the way he looks with the fast breaks. His ankles immediately got sounder. And that was a pretty aggressive pullback. But the reason why he didn't get sore is because we did not take anything off the bottom of his foot. I found that if you have this type of issue where you have to be aggressive, be ultra very conservative on the bottom of the foot and you won't get these horses sore. This is a filly that grabbed this foot on something in her stall. We never did figure out how she did it. California Nectar was aiming for 2 stake races in a 2-week period. And this was bleeding on her when she would track. But we didn't want to get into it too soon before the race because she wasn't sore. So she breezed and had 3 days that she was going to walk. So we went to drying this foot out, making sure that we have no infection here. And now we're going to go ahead and patch this because she's going to run in about 4 days. And then she's going to run right back again 18 days later. You can see we cleaned up the foot. And then I packed this with some Play-Doh. And the reason why I packed it with Play-Doh is because I don't want any glue to hit that tender area of the hook there, because I'm going to glue on a plate. Now, generally, I would glue this plate on a little higher, but we weren't sure that this was going to hold. And we wanted to make sure that we get medicated to get her through this first race. Then we would take the patch off and get it ready for the second race. Well, it held, didn't bleed, she won both stakes, and everything came out fine. We took this patch off about 40 days later. That's what I generally do, is take them off about 40 to 45 days later and then filled it in when she was fine. This is a horse named Orbach that was transferred to Doug O'Neill because they just couldn't quite get this thing healed up to run. This horse is in 5 days, or going to be entered 5 days later. So you can see they have 8 screws here. But as you also can see, the entire crack is above those screws. Now I could put some screws in here. I generally put 2 screws, one here and one here. We've got this issue to deal with, and I'm afraid that this undermining is going to not allow a screw to hold this together. And we've got this horse in 5 days, so we have to get this thing patched up. You see it's dry. There's no concern of infection. We just need to stabilize this thing so he can run. He's not unsound. I do think that he's probably been bleeding here prior to us getting him. So we glued a plate on him also. Now, there's no screws underneath this. And he ended up running second and then came back, continued training, and won 4 of his next 7 with this patch on for about, I think, the first 3 wins. We left it on for about 2 months because of the damage that was done underneath there. Took it off, filled everything out, filled it. You'll notice that on both of my horses that had these quarter cracks, my 3/4 shoes, I believe that this is a necessity. You take the pressure off of here. You take that pressure and jamming up this heel, eliminate it, and this patch is going to do its job. Now, I work with Bobby Frankel, and if Bobby Frankel ever 3/4 a shoe on a horse, he never had a full shoe on that foot again. I do things a little differently. If I have a horse that gets sore in a heel, I'll 3/4 it. Once that horse gets sound again, I will try him again with a full shoe. If he gets sore a second time, as long as I have anything to do with the horse, he will not wear a full shoe. He'll remain 3/4 and have a lot of success. I run a lot of horses with 3/4 shoes. The horse Lava Man ran a good portion of his career and made an awful lot of that $5 million running in 3/4 front shoes. This is a horse named Sticky Candy that we claim. And we brought this horse out the next day, knowing we had to do something because he was so uncomfortable that we just thought something really bad was going on with this horse's feet. That's an ugly foot. And you can see that foot's been ugly for most of his life. You see all the rings in his feet, see all the damage. My guess is this horse was not shod prior to running because he is tender-footed and they just wanted to be sure that he was going to be able to run. They were very fortunate because we claimed them. I, on the other hand, wasn't that fortunate. You see the damage on this foot where the quarter crack is. We have a patch here that has a drain, so we know we had an issue here at one time. You see a blowout here, and then another blowout. And obviously the issues with his walls. This is what we did. We put blue shoes on this horse. And as you can see, this side is three-quartered. I left the patch with the drain because it didn't appear to be an issue, and we just didn't want to open up too many cans of worms with this horse when he was as uncomfortable as he was. Now, this horse had difficulty standing for glue on shoes. He was very uncomfortable, very kind horse to work on, but he was just really uncomfortable. We got him looking pretty good. We got his toe back here. We've taken out the concern with the nails. And I want to refer back to this picture that I just showed you. You see this circled area here? Now this horse took over an hour to shoe with just two shoes. That's not normally the case, even for glue ons, but he was very uncomfortable. So when I was done, I went back and took some pictures. Didn't see anything abnormal until I got home and developed those pictures on my computer. And that's what I saw. I lowered this horse because he was very high here. I drastically lowered him and allowed this area to relax. He has a three-quarter shoe, thereby taking off all this pressure. That coronet band relaxed that much in 1 hour. Before and after. That is 1 hour, and that coronet band has relaxed. And believe me, that was one of the reasons why he was sore. This is the same foot 40 days later. I've taken off the patch. There was nothing serious underneath. There's some glue here just filling in the wall that needed to be cut out. He now has some Curtis Burns polyflex shoes glued on. And you can see this area where that blowout was. I cleaned it out. I didn't fill it with glue at this time because I just didn't want to irritate this tissue here. I bet you're thinking that this horse went on to just be an incredible winning machine. For some reason, this horse absolutely would not run worth a darn after we got him going. And I truly believe he just didn't want to leave our care. He was sound. He would want to go to the track every day. But he just couldn't run. I want to take you back to where we started, where I said, don't forget about the crucial role played by the farrier in that horse's success. Well, I know if you shoe horses at the racetrack, you've lost some shoes. And you've lost some shoes in races. This is a shoe I wish I lost in the race. This filly stumbled badly out of the gate and grabbed her right front medial heel, pulling this shoe down about 2 inches. She ran the entire race with it on. When she got back to the barn, I removed the shoe. We pulled this the foot for the evening, and we had intentions of putting the shoe on the next day. Well, when I came to the barn, she was completely lame. We x-rayed the foot and found a fractured hoof and wing. Now, I wish the shoe would come off. And if you get approached by a trainer and says, hey, that horse lost a shoe yesterday working or racing, just say you're welcome. These things will come off. It's a 4-ounce shoe on a 1,000-pound horse. I don't think this shoe has any chance of staying on if the horse stands on himself in the gate or grabs himself coming out of the gate. So I'm not a big believer that horses didn't win because they lost shoes. I've got some pictures of horses that won graded stakes that lost a shoe in a race.
Okay, everybody. Thanks a lot, Jim. And this is Jeremy from American Farriers Journal again. And what we'll do, we'll jump into a question and answer session. If you still would like, go ahead and you can see on the control panel from GoToWebinar, there's a field to submit questions, and then we'll go through as many as possible. So let me start with this one. Jim, overall, what approach would you advise for thoroughbreds off the track, say used for jumping, that to treat long toe, low heel issues?
I like to use a blunt toe shoe. At the racetrack, we would use a fast break. If you set those shoes back, you don't have to rest the toe back. You can leave that toe hang over and allow it to wear normally and just improve the breakover by having the blunt toe shoe on the bottom, and naturally that toe will wear back as the horse uses it.
Someone's interested in how you keep your records. How often do you get calls from other trainers or farriers referring to your system, the horses that you've kept?
Well, I get calls from trainers that I've worked in the past that know that I keep the notes, and I'll get asked by horseshoers, you know, what issues you had. If I have a horse that's claimed out of my barn, I will tell the horseshoer if we have a horse that needs to be tranquilized, or a horse that, you know, we have a three-quarter shoe on there because he's had a lot of issues with quarter cracks. And we also send the notes to the farm. When the horse goes back to the farm, we send the notes with the horses so that the farm can see what we've been doing with the horse, or if the horse changes trainers, like say a horse goes from Doug O'Neill to one of our trainers that we use up north or even on the East Coast, we'll send those notes with the horse so that they have a history of what we've done with the horse.
Here's a question from someone currently in a shoeing school. What advice do you have for getting work on tracks?
It's difficult. When I started, at a training center called San Luis Ray Downs. The best way is to get out of school, make your mistakes somewhere other than the racetrack, because if you come here and make mistakes, you'll never get away from them, and you will make mistakes. I'd like to tell people to trim as many horses as possible. You can trim three in the time, or maybe four in the time that you shoe one. So get to somewhere where you can shoe as many horses, or shoe, excuse me, trim as many horses as possible, and then start shoeing. And then if you can get to a farm that trains thoroughbreds and breaks thoroughbreds to come to the racetrack, that's a good start. Come to the racetrack and talk to us. You know, we'll help you out. And we have a test in California, and I'm on the board that gives a test, and I always am happy to help people prepare for the test.
Okay, going back to the horse in the video, with a horse like that on the track that's been sedated, do you need to report it?
We do not need to report it. It's on the veterinarian's list. That I didn't sedate it, though. The veterinarian comes and sedated, so it's on his veterinarian list. And, of course, we won't sedate a horse that's going to run within 2 days. We use something called the Morsovan and Torque, and that clears the system in 2 days. It's what they even use to inject ankles and stuff. They usually use it 2 to 3 days out, and there's no issue.
Yeah.
It works quick and clears the system quick.
Okay. Do you use a hoof tester when you come across a bruised frog?
When I see a bruise, it's behind me. It's something that caused the horse problem prior to me seeing it. It's kind of like when you see a nail that has the blood underneath it, like you hit it with a hammer. It doesn't hurt now, it hurt when it happened. And that's the same thing with this type of bruise that we saw in the video. Now, if this horse had been reported to me by the groom or the trainer that morning that we've had an issue on this filly's left front foot, you might want to check that out. Yeah, we would use hoof testers, but she had not shown any soreness from the last time she was shod, and she had never had any history of bruising in her feet. That was just simply something where she stepped on something on the racetrack, most likely.
Do you find all of the trainers you work with are as willing to put confidence in your opinions as Doug O'Neill?
I am very fortunate. Mike Michalski, Mark Blatt, Mike Mitchell, they value my opinion and they leave me alone. So if I shoe a horse and I see something that I have to get aggressive with or I'm concerned about, I can go in and write a note for Doug or send him a text message or Mike Mitchell, this horse needs to walk for 3 days and then pack walk for 3 days. If that horse is aiming for a race, that race will be bypassed. They know that I'm there for the horse. My number one concern is the horse. If we don't run in a week, we'll run in 2 weeks. And I realize that it's an economic issue, but I'm not here for economics. I'm here for the horse. I represent the horse. Doug O'Neill is my client. Mike Mitchell is my client. The horse is my customer.
Okay. In terms of the problems you find, how much of the work that you have on the track is more of a maintenance of soundness versus some of the therapeutic things you've shown?
Much more, you know, just keeping the maintenance up. You know, we shoe our horses every 25 to 35 days. We don't run into these problems every day. We just need to be equipped and know how to fix these problems. If a horse needs time, of course, we will give a horse time. But time is a monetary factor that always has to be considered. We're not going to take a horse that's not sound and try to do things to him to get them to run. But these are minor things. Some of them are major and needed some of these jobs like sticky candy. He didn't run for a while. But for the most part, you know, it's the maintenance stuff that we do every day.
Do you have any tips for working with aluminum? Maybe a tip about shaping?
Yeah, don't overshape. Like I said in the video, you don't want to close that shoe and then open that shoe. That's a time factor. Now I use on these 4 ounce shoes, I use a 1 pound hammer. I can't remember who makes that hammer. It's something that it's similar to the one that they sell at Rick Redden's site, Manrick. It's a great hammer, it's really well balanced. And I just would say be cautious not to overshape and then have to open it up again.
How do you decide to use a polyflex shoe?
If I need to put on a shoe without nails, I'm going to go through one of the three shoes: a polyflex shoe, an aluminum shoe that's glued on, or a sticky shoe. And it'll just be different factors in the horse's foot that I'm going to consider. Now, if I'm working on a horse with a quarter crack, I may not want that expansion and contraction that we get from the Burns polyflex shoe. If I have a narrow-footed horse, I don't want to restrict that with a regular glue-on shoe, and I'll use a polyflex shoe.
How do you pull shoes that are glued on?
You snap right at the heel. You snap on both sides, and they come off unbelievably easy. It's really amazing how easy they come off once you snap them.
Another question about your computer notes. You had some abbreviations like Q4, K1. What do those indications mean?
Okay, that is, I can give you quickly off the top of my head some of my abbreviations. The Q stands for Queen's Plates. An FB would be Fast Break. A T would be Toe Grabs. That's what you use behind. And you may see TSB, Thin Shelly Brittle Walls. So what I've done is I know what they mean. And if I transfer those notes to a farm, I go back and doctor them and take the TSB off and put Thin Shelly Brittle Walls. So these are, in order to make all the information fit on the lines that I have, I need to make some abbreviations. Otherwise, I have to have two lines for each. And then the problem with that is if you have two lines for each, when you try to sort them alphabetically, you lose the second line because it doesn't have a name to it.
For dealing with sheared heels, what shoe do you generally use?
You know, I'm going to make that call when I get to the foot, but most likely I'm going to try to get that foot round, or I'm going to use a Fast Break blunt toe, and I'm going to set it back. A sheared heel, you're going to have a lower heel, you're going to have a longer toe, so I want that break over to improve. I want it back to where it should be, so I'm going to use either a King's Plate and go with a rounded toe, or if I have to be more aggressive, I'll go with a Fast Break.
Can you talk a little bit about the challenges you face with surface changes on California tracks?
Well, sadly, we have three racetracks in Southern California, Hollywood Park, Del Mar, and Santa Anita, and they're night and day surfaces. We have a poly track down at Del Mar, a mixture of poly track and dirt and everything else at Hollywood Park, and at Santa Anita, they just put a dirt track back in. Now, we have found, or I found, that horses don't slide as much when they run on the poly racetracks. So when I go to Del Mar, no toe grabs, front nor hind. When I come back to Hollywood Park, we will put the toe grabs back on some horses. If they have a back issue and we feel that they're not sliding enough, we'll take the toe grab off and run them at Hollywood Park with no toe grabs. At Santa Anita, because of the dirt track, we use toe grabs. Now, when the rain comes, I don't make a lot of changes. I have a firm belief that there is no shoe that you can put on a racehorse that's going to make them want to run in the mud. If they don't like the mud, they're not going to run. I use the smallest, I think they're called mud nails from Mustad, a number 4 mud nail. Sometimes I drive them into the foot, and sometimes if I'm shoeing a horse a day of the race or a day or two and we know it's going to be muddy, we'll rivet them in the heel. And that, I'm going to tell you, is for one reason only, and that's to light the board for mud cock so that the owner and the jockey feel comfortable, because I don't think it makes a bit of difference.
Let's see here. Is there anything you can do to the hoof for a horse that's having trouble switching leads?
I mean, that's a good question there. Yeah. A few years ago, I had a horse called Thor's Echo, and he was getting ready to run in the Breeders' Cup Sprint at Churchill Downs. And I just wasn't comfortable with the way he was running. He seemed to be fading at the end of his races and switching back over to his left lead. Well, I looked at him and talked to my riders all the time. They're going to tell me more things than you can believe. You can just get great information from your riders. And they said, he's always done that. He gets tired in his work. Well, he had a right front heel that was a little more sheared, and I think he was getting fatigued. And he was switching back over about 100 yards before the wire, and he just wasn't running to his full potential. Well, I took and put a left toe shoe on him, but I rounded the left front so that it was more rounded. I didn't put, you know, tradition on one and a blunt on the other. I just rounded that blunt toe, and I made that breakover just a little quicker. That son of a gun won the Breeders' Cup Sprint, and then he came right back and won a big race in I think it was in Maryland or someplace, and he wound up being Sprinter of the Year. So those are factors that, you know, if you see a horse or you get some information, I think you need to figure out a way to make that where the horse is more comfortable.
We've got a couple more questions we'll go through, and this one is kind of a interest in track shoeing, and how many horses would you typically do in the day, and what do you do to regulate your schedule to determine the number of horses you do per day or per week?
I've never been a person that shoes a lot of horses, even in my prime when I was young. 8 horses might be the max. I go to all my barns in the morning, and I start with the people that can start me early, and I set my schedule, and I try to allot 1 hour per horse. That gives me time to set up. You see my truck where I have to pull everything out and push everything back if I have to go to multiple barns. And I try to set up 6 to 8 horses a day. Now, since I went, I just shoe for Doug O'Neill now. I will shoe any horse that needs me for other trainers. I look at a lot of horses for other trainers, and I shoe some of them. Some of them I just give suggestions. I only shoe for Doug, and I shoe about 4 horses a day now. And the reason why I do that is he likes me to travel with his horses. I was out of the state, out of 6 weeks for the Triple Crown, I was out of the state 3 weeks. So it's very difficult for me to work for other people now. Plus, I'm recuperating from a shoulder surgery. But I like to just set up my time period at the racetrack where I start, let's say my earliest barn can start at 7, and I go 1 hour period. I'll put an hour break after 4 horses or 5 horses just in case I run into something that needed more time, and then I schedule the other horses.
Okay. And as our final question, I'd probably be remiss that a couple of people want to know this. What is it like to shoe a Kentucky Derby winner?
Oh, my God. You know, I've had some people tell me that, you know, when you win a race like that, that it's no big deal, you know, it's just another race. And I've shot some winners of some incredible races, the Breeders' Cup Sprints, the mare race, the classic with Alphabet Soup. But I've gone to Kentucky twice for the Derby, and the first time we didn't run real well, but this time we won it. And standing out there on that grass, looking at those stands and those people cheering for us, and knowing what we went through to get that horse there, it was just an unbelievable experience. I mean, that and the Preakness was the race that I'll have another ran to beat Bodemeister was just one of the most incredible races to just nail him right on the wire. I mean, there, you can't put it in words.